A very good morning to everyone. I, Anindya Konar, welcome you to Personality Development Workshop 2020. Personality Development Workshop organized by Center for Legal Studies, Geetharathan International Business School. Geetharathan International Business School was established in the year 2004. GIBS is affiliated to Guru Gobind Singh Indaprastha University, Delhi, and approved. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Welcome to our workshop.
Thank you very much.
A very good morning to everyone. I, Anindya Konar, welcome you to our Personality Development Workshop 2020 organized by Center for Legal Studies, Geetharathan International Business School. Geetharathan International Business School was established in the year 2004. GIBS is affiliated to Guru Gobind Singh Indaprastha University, Delhi, and is approved by All India Council for Technical Education, Ministry of HRD, Government of India for its technical courses, and Bar Council of India for its law courses. The institute is assessed as category A+ by Joint Assessment Committee of Government of NCT of Delhi and Guru Gobind Singh Indaprastha University. The institute conducts MBA, MBA International Business, MCA, BBA, BA LLB, and BBA LLB courses. The theme for today's PD workshop is Court Craft and Drafting. And for today's workshop, our speaker is Honorable Advocate Mahendra Kumar Dhingda, sir. Sir, we heartily welcome you for becoming part of our workshop.
Thank you. It's my delight. Thank you.
Advocate M.K. Dhingra, sir, is a person who wears many hats. He is an advocate, a management professional, a trainer, a teacher, a speaker at the same time. He has long association with institutes like Faculty of Management Studies, University of Delhi, Institute of Chartered Accountants, various companies and law firm. Sir, we are truly honored to have you as our speaker. Now, I would request you, Honorable Speaker, to carry forward the rest of the session.
Thank you.
Sir.
Good morning to you all present in the webinar today. It's my privilege and my pleasure to host and present this particular webinar on a topic which is court craft and drafting. It's a very challenging topic, and I'm happy that your institute has given me this opportunity to discuss this with you, the bright young students and budding lawyers for tomorrow. I welcome you once again to this webinar, and I hope that we will have some takeaways from this. I have to facilitate my verbal presentation, extempore presentation. I have also prepared a few slides for your comprehension, for your easier understanding. So we will travel along together, and at the end or near the end of the session, we would have some questions if you have any doubts or any questions you want to clarify. So we'll begin straight away. This is a good initiative by GIBS. I have been associated with them for quite some time now, and I find that this particular institution does a lot of things which go to the development, I would say overall development including the personality development of the students that it has enrolled, which is so much different from what I find elsewhere. So I must really appreciate to begin with. It's a very good initiative and it must be carried on. Now, the topic for today is Codecraft and drafting. Now, it's a very relevant topic for all you young lawyers aspiring to be successful in life. I'm sure you have chosen law as a career with an objective in mind, with a purpose in mind, because we must have a purpose before we embark on a journey. We must have the destination in mind as to where we are heading to. Because unless you know where we are heading to, we will definitely end up there. Because all roads will take us there. Because we do not know where we are going. So any road will take us there. So to be successful, we must know what is the purpose. Now, the purpose, as far as you young lawyers are concerned, is to become a successful lawyer. The school which you are in, the college, university you are in today, is taking good care of you. Your parents are providing all the facilities that you need to accomplish yourself in the field of education. Your institution is taking care of you for your educational needs. But tomorrow onwards, that is when you pass out from this particular institution, enroll with Bar Council of Delhi or any other bar council in the country, and appear for the All India Bar Examination, you will be entitled to practice law in the courts of the country. That is when the real life or the professional life for you starts. We have academic syllabus, calendar, everything. But I don't think any university teaches court craft as a practical discipline. We may have moot courts. We may have exposure to n number of professional books, but there is nothing like experiencing it yourself. So I would develop on Codecraft in some greater detail and the qualities required for you to become a successful lawyer. And incidentally, let me begin by saying that drafting is an important aspect of the skill called Codecraft. So we'll take it along and then we'll move onwards. Now, when we go to the next slide, let me just see. Can we have the next slide, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we have it here. Yeah, I could get it. Yeah. So what is the next slide saying? It says, what are the objectives? As I said in the beginning, we must know what are we embarking upon in our journey. So we must know what are we trying to achieve today. So the webinar objects to achieve understanding of the code craft. As the title says of the today's webinar, Codecraft and drafting. So we must understand what exactly is Codecraft. We must understand what exactly is drafting. And then what is the takeaway for you? Why are we doing it? So let's begin. All of us know what law is. I'm sure most of the audience today is of ninth semester or maybe seventh semester. So we know what law is. And if I were to ask you what law is, probably most of you would come and tell me, sir, it is a set of rules and regulation formulated or drafted by the sovereign for its subjects to be complied with, failing which non-compliance leads to punishment and fine or both. Very good academic definition. But as lawyers or advocates, term used interchangeably, we must know what is beyond this definition. So I will introduce you to the concept of the human element here. What is the law trying to regulate? The law is trying to regulate relationships, be it relationships between individuals, human beings, be it relationships between the individual and the corporates, the living entity corporates, who are again managed by individuals. So what are we trying to achieve? We are trying to manage relationships between living human beings. So if we are managing relationships, there are bound to be conflicts, and law seeks to not only regulate the behavior or the relationships, but also resolve the conflicts that may happen in due course of conducting the relations. That is what the law stands for me. You have to see the relation part of it, the human relations here, because as per the academic definition just now read out to you or spoken to you, it is only a definition. Beyond that, I can say it's only a cold print. Cold print means it does not speak. You have to read it. So you have to read it between the lines, understand the emotions, emotive element, because the person who drafted the law, persons who legislated the law, the person who is implementing the law, the person who is administering the law, and for the person who is following the law, they all have emotions. So there is a human element into it. The relationships are at stake and the rights and duties are at stake. So we must read law as something, not only academic definition, but also managing human relationships, regulating them. So that is where the role of a lawyer or advocate will come in, as we'll see down the line in today's presentation. Now, all of us are aware as to what is the typical legal system looks like. In India, for example, we have the superior judiciary, the Supreme Court, the high courts, and the district courts at the district level for easier administrative convenience, and other subordinate courts, which could be metropolitan courts or sub courts and all that. There are basically three pillars or arms of this particular system. The advocates, which could include designated senior advocates. You know, they are designated senior advocates. However, as we'll see later, everybody enjoys same rights when we are standing before the bench. You understand what is the bar and the bench. So when we are standing before the judge, whether it's a senior advocate as an adversary before you or an advocate, all are equal. Whether you have 1 year experience, whether you have 20 years experience, all of them are advocates arguing their case before the honorable court. Then there is a paralegal staff, which we call them munshis or the clerks or court clerks, and the people who draft. And there are some others who could be involved in the administrative functions for advocates. Then there are litigants. I've just taken two categories, petitioners and appellants, because we have a system where we have right of appeal also. The losing party gets to appeal. So I've taken petitioners in the broader sense of the term. I've taken appellates in the broader sense of the term. And there could be other nomenclatures for the litigants, depending on what kind of a case and matter we are talking about. So let's not get into that much in detail. But we know legal system consists of courts, advocates, and litigants. In today's topic, we are more concerned as to what is an advocate going to do regarding court craft. Of course, it is about managing the affairs in the court. Courts, three components. The judge or the honorable judge, which will manage its own administration as to how he's going to administer justice to the litigants and the advocates who come to him. But we are concerned with what an advocate will do. Who is an advocate? Who is a lawyer? You know, these terms are used interchangeably. But to my mind, lawyer is somebody who is just qualified enough by a degree of law, and advocate is somebody who is entitled to practice law in the honorable courts. our Advocates Act 1961 also defines who is an advocate. World over, there are different terms used for the lawyers, the advocates, the solicitors, the barristers. But in India, we'll stick to advocate. Generally call it lawyer. Also sometimes, who's your lawyer? We don't say who's your advocate in common parlance. So we continue to use these words interchangeably. Now, I've taken you to the human aspect of the lawyer, the human aspect of the law. We are all human beings. And the duties we are going to perform are again going to be addressing the concerns of humans, getting the resolution from a human being. So we have to be conscious about the element of human nature also in whatever we do. So advocate has a very, very responsible role to play in the society. All of us know, it is said that advocacy is one of the noble professions, the medicine or the doctors being the other one. Yes, well said. It is a noble profession because we are in the profession, not in business of making money. We are there to serve people, the needs of the society when they are in distress, when they are in need of our services. So we are in a noble profession. But on the lighter side, if I see you become a lawyer tomorrow, you are going to be facing the challenges of real life. If I'm allowed to use, this kind of a lighter anecdote, you would have seen matrimonial ads in the newspapers. Most of you would have seen in the family, newspapers. What is in demand? The girls are looking for the civil servants, the chartered accountants, the management graduates. But is any girl looking for an advocate? Or other way around, is any boy looking for an advocate? Very rarely. So they say, you may be in a noble profession, but we don't want you. Because nobody wants to end up in trouble. Even though we may be there in the society to take care of others' troubles. But nobody wants us. So lighter side, if you were to see, nobody wants to get married to you as a matter of choice. Nobody wants to give you a house on rent if you tell them that you are a lawyer. Nobody wants to extend a loan to you easily because they know that chances of recovery would become relatively bleaker. So on a lighter side, though we are in noble profession, we are looked down upon differently. But that is on a lighter side. But that doesn't mean that we should not take our responsibility seriously. It continues to be a noble profession, let me assure you. Because when you do good things for society, society will respect you. So it gives a message to us. We must do good so that we earn the respect. And probably you are aware now, the Advocates Act also gives you a privileged status that you, an advocate, enjoy a status which is privileged. You cannot be proceeded against in any court of law for the advice you give, for the kind of arguments you make. So there is an immunity. You cannot be proceeded against for your professional conduct unless it is crossing the boundaries and becoming a misconduct as defined in the Advocates Act. So we have a responsibility which we have all to live up to. Let's see. Now, let's see court craft. We'll see what is the definition of court craft, but let's understand. So I have brought into the picture the personality of an advocate because we are taking it from the point of view of an advocate. Court craft concerns the judge also, the litigant also, as to how he has to behave and conduct in the court. It applies to all three components, that is the judge, the advocate, and the litigant. But we'll take it from the point of view of an advocate. Now, advocate's personality has to have ethics and values. How? What is the difference between ethics and values? Ethics, as you all know, is a set of moral behavior guided by a code. Ethical code is always in a written form mandated to you by some authority. Like Advocates Act says that these are the code for conduct. Or say somebody gives you a rule for employment or behavior in a particular office. That is what is ethics. Values, on the other hand, are your beliefs, your judgments in life. What you feel and judge is good for you. They may be wrong. They may be societally wrong. But that is your belief that you believe it is to be correct. So your values, like we call it sanskar. So we know a personality of an advocate must have the components of ethics, that we must be ethical. We will see how when we move on in the presentation today as to how we look at ethics in greater detail. Advocacy. What is advocacy? The art of advocating. Basically, you are going to solve the problem of a litigant who is in distress, who is in problem, because either his rights have been taken away or he is not able to perform his obligation, so therefore he is being proceeded against. So we have to help him either way, because as an advocate, you might end up on the either side of the table. Means maybe someday you are for the prosecution, other day you are for the defense. So you must have skills to handle both the sides. Means you should be able to prosecute as well as defend. Now, what is an art and what is a science? Have you ever thought, why are you using these words for advocacy? What has art and science got to do with advocacy? You know, art, this is an activity which involves expression and application of human skill and imagination. We are all familiar with pieces of art, but we are talking of beautiful objects. But we are talking of here the art of expressing yourself, applying your skill, imagination to present a situation. So, which also probably would include your body language. So, we know what an art is, how useful it is to an advocate. What is science then got to do with the advocacy? Science, as you know, is an intellectual and practical activity. It's a practical activity which encompasses the systematic study of organized body of knowledge. So what does it do? We have a set of facts. We organize it systematically. We compile the evidence supporting the facts. As you know, you will also understand we have to apply law to the facts, law to the set of facts, not the other way around. Most young lawyers do that mistake. They apply facts to a set of laws, whereas the judge does what? He applies law to the set of facts presented to him by both the parties. So we have to have a situation where we know what is the applicability of art and science to advocacy. So I would say advocacy is art as well as science and a combination of both. A lawyer has to have art in his personality. He has to be having a scientific temper to be able to do it successfully. Now, skills and competence. Now, what is a skill? What is a competence? You're all familiar with the words efficient and effective. Simple words, probably you would have heard earlier also, part of the vocabulary. But what is being skillful? What is being competent? You are said to be competent if you do something successfully or efficiently. Another matter, whether you are doing the right thing or the wrong thing. So you are successful in doing it efficiently. I have not gone into the details whether you are doing the right thing to do. You may be doing the wrong thing to do, but you are doing it efficiently. On the other hand, skill is the power of doing something competently and effectively. Means efficiently and effectively both. So skill means what? You are able to do the right things. Effective means right things, and efficient means things right. So you have to do right things in the right manner. Means you have to have skills, you have to have competence. Now, skill is something which needs to be acquired and learned. For example, the language skills. For example, the public speaking skills. So these are skills which you have to learn. Now, when an advocate has a personality which encompasses good ethics, good values. He is competent to argue, present himself in terms of advocacy. He knows what his competence is, what his skills are, means he can do the things, right things in the right manner, then that is all going to help in court craft. And that is what for me is exactly the court craft. Let's see the so-called definition now of the court craft. What is court craft? The definition as per Webster's dictionary says the art or craft of conducting the affairs of the court. We discussed that already. Now, we also know what is the art. Means how you manage a particular situation, a particular way. So everybody is creative enough. So judge also would be creative enough. You will find all judges are unique. All the advocates are unique. And you to have a unique personality. So the person who is managing the court is the presiding officer, the judge. So he will manage, he will direct you as to what is to be done, in what manner. So as far as he is concerned, he is conducting the affairs. Now, we as an advocate have to conduct ourselves in terms of what is being expected of us. So we will conduct the affair, what is our responsibility. You are aware, Advocates Act 1961 entitles us, gives us the privileged status of officers of the court. That is a privileged status. You are as much a part of the court system as the judge is, because what are you trying to do? You are trying to discover the truth in the interest of justice. That's what the judge is also doing. And you are only assisting the judge in discovering the truth from the given set of facts as to whether you are good or the other party is true. So that is what the art or craft of conducting the affairs is. Now, what is a craft? Craft again says it's an activity involving skills. We have already discussed skills. Skills is a learned behavior, learned knowledge, which you can always acquire. Now, lightheartedly, we can also say it's an ability to deceive others. We say that he's a very crafty person. Means he can get out of situations. He can easily make you believe something which may not be true. So in that sense of the term, it's a craft. So advocacy also is a crafty business. You have to make the litigant understand first, because when he's walking to you as a client, you have to make sure that you understand him and he understands your point of view. And then you have to make sure that the honorable presiding officer understands what you want to say. And sometimes, I would not say deceive, you have to make him believe that what you are saying is the only truth available in this. And everybody else is not creatable. So there lies your craft. Then comes the skill, which is a learned power of doing something competently. You discussed what is competence, what is skill. So I'll not dwell on this, but we have to have a developed aptitude. Aptitude means willingness to learn, to acquire the ability. So that is how we are defining the definition of court craft. Let's see the next part. Let's touch upon briefly as to what is legal drafting. Now, I have discussed the personality of an advocate that is required to conduct the court craft from his point of view, for his part to be played in the total system. Now, that is a very important aspect, because in you and your capability, how you put up the whole thing depends the fate of the litigant. It is not going to matter to the honorable presiding officer, the judge, as to which way the court decides the matter, who wins the case, who loses the case. It is immaterial, because the judges decide on law. They decide not on emotions. They decide not on the parties involved. They decide on the points of law. End of the day, it may also not matter to the advocate. He may win a case, get laurels. He may lose a case, maybe lose some clients or lose some reputation. But the litigant is the one who is going to either enjoy the fruits or suffer the loss. So an important tool for court craft, for a lawyer's armory, is the document you present to the court. Now, what is document? The document is the petition, the pleadings, the written statements, and so forth. Whatever documents you're submitting, the applications, they have to be given to the Honorable Court for a communication to him or the court as to what is that your point of view is. What is that you have to say or say? So it's the most important instrument of legal communication from one to another. Now, communication is happening in two stages here. First, the client, when he's walking to you, he will give you some information. Client counseling also is a very important aspect of advocate's life. Now, the client would not give you all the information that you need. So you have to solicit information from him so that you are able to build up a good case for him. He may hide things which he thinks are not important, therefore not to be disclosed. But you have to explain to him that you enjoy a relationship which is fiduciary, relationship of trust, and he must give you all the information that you need. Maybe important from his point of view, maybe not so important from his point of view, but maybe it is material information which will help you to decide the case or take the case in one particular direction. So that's also an art. Probably we'll discuss some other time the client counseling part of it. So let's come back to the drafting being an important instrument of communication, because we are coming out of the document at end of the day, and then that is the document which is being presented to the court. What it does, it crystallizes the expression. What do you want to say to the court? You are just crystallizing, means you are doing so many things and filtering the relevant material information for digestion and consideration of the court. So what are you trying to tell him? That what is my legal right? What is my privilege as a litigant? What is my status today and how my rights have been affected, and what is the redressal I'm looking at? So to do all this, you have to do things at a twin level. You have to do conceptual as well as verbal part. You have to think first and then compose the drafting. So drafting is basically a two-step process. It involves lot of gray matter and then thereafter the expression. So therefore, the vocabulary becomes very, very important here. We'll move on to the next slide. Now, what are the skills or qualities required? Why we call them he's a good advocate? Why we call them he's not so good of advocate or so good a person? So having said that, there is a human element, there is an emotive element in all what we do, because ultimately litigant also is a human being. He is having a relationship with you as an advocate. You are having a relationship with him as a client. And therefore, you have to be compassionate to his misery, his distress. So like in the picture you see here, you have to handhold him. Give him some coolness in his mind. Give him some comfort. That is what the quality a good lawyer should have. He should feel that he's in safe hands. His interests are going to be protected. That will make you a good lawyer. That will earn you good kudos from most of the litigants. You, for that to be done, that's the first part. Okay, you have done very good. He has come to you. You have offered him a cup of tea, made him comfortable. But beyond that, your actual caliber will work. What is that? Your knowledge. Knowledge cannot be an overnight affair. You have to acquire it over a period of time. So you have to have knowledge of the subject, that is the court craft itself, as to what facts are there, how you are going to assimilate them, coordinate them, and put it in a form that the judge understands as to what you want. And there comes the communication part. Communication is as much effective as you want it to be. Communication, probably all of us believe, most of us believe, is a one-way process. It is never a one-way process. Communication is a very, very wide and broad subject. It is always a two-way process. Communication could also be by body language. It may not be verbal only. It can be non-verbal as well. It can be at a mental level also. It can be at a physical level also. It can be at even a nod is good enough a communication. Keeping quiet also is a communication. So communication can take many forms. So you should not only be able to speak, but understand communication per se as a concept very, very clearly. And the role of communication that is going to be there in your overall advocacy. Now, you're all aware, we have the Advocates Act 1961 in place. It lays down the duties for an advocate. Duties, ethics for the conduct of an advocate. What he should do, what are the duties towards the court? Like, for example, I'm not going to those. Let's see a couple of them. Like, you should respect the court. You should follow the decorum. You know, you should obey the court. And you should be in a proper uniform, whatever. Fellow advocate means you must respect him. You must respect him for his personality, ability, not be hostile. And for litigant, of course, you have to be truthful to him in terms of the fees charged, in terms of the advice given to the best of your ability. I'm not going too much into details because that is part of the professional ethics program, which I'm sure you have gone through in a different paper in your syllabus. Let's see now, to make a successful advocate, to be able to do court craft in a very, very effective manner, what do? We have something called the seven lamps for an advocate, for successful advocacy, for successful court crafting. Lord Barnett was there. He was a British judge. He formulated this almost a century back, and which holds true today also. Like, for example, the Criminal Procedure Code, the IPC, Lord Macaulay formulated them when? More than 1.5 century ago. But they are still there. Human offenses, the mode of offense may have changed, but the offenses against the human body, the human person, have not changed. So there is a foresight there. So similarly here, what we see, a lawyer is supposed to be honest. A lawyer is supposed to be courageous. A lawyer is supposed to be industrious. A lawyer is supposed to be having a wit and humor. He must have eloquence. He must be judgmental. And he must have sense of fellowship. Let us see in greater detail as to how they are relevant to our court craft business, which we are discussing today. Recently, the Honorable Justice Deepak Gupta retired from the Supreme Court of India. You are aware probably. What was his address to the Young Lawyers Forum, Supreme Court? His only advice was, sit in courtrooms, not in bar rooms, to learn court craft from seniors. Just take Deepak Gupta's advice to budding young lawyers, speaking at a virtual farewell meeting by the Supreme Court Young Lawyers Forum. I have intentionally included this picture here to emphasize on the fact that these things, I may give you a presentation today. You might have all the concepts clear in your mind, but unless you do it yourself, observe it yourself, and thereafter practice it yourself, court craft will not come to you. You will never be proficient in court craft. So you have to do it by observing the seniors who have learned from experience and kept on improving themselves. What it means? You must go to courts. When you join the bar, you will have plenty of time on your hands, because you will be a briefless lawyer to begin with, right? So one advice there to you, you will have free time. Don't wait in the library. Don't wait in the canteen of the court. Go to the courtroom. You will always have few takeaways when you walk out. Whether you spend half an hour there, whether you spend 1 hour over there, you will always have a takeaway. You will see some senior or legal luminary arguing his case, and the judge fearlessly taking on the senior advocates also. So the fact remains, you learn a lot from a practical experience. So there lies the advice to you: seize the opportunity. There may be a situation when a brief comes to you, but it doesn't offer much of a money. But you have just come into profession. If you are supposed doing all it on your own, you have to not be greedy. You have to grab at the situation, grab at the opportunity, seize the opportunity. Because opportunity once gone, never comes back. And each opportunity is a situation to learn from. You will learn from an experience of conducting the case yourself. So seize the opportunity. And you can seize the opportunity of learning also in courtrooms, not in the bar rooms, as was very rightly said by Justice Deepak Gupta, because he is speaking from his experience and from what he's seen in the court. So let's get back to the first slam, which we said is industry. It's not the industry we understand in terms of the agriculture industry and business and profession. We are talking of being industrious. Let me tell you, the advocacy is an industrious business. Means it involves lot of physical hard work, lot of mental work. So you be prepared to be industrious. Lot of hard work has to go into your career, in shaping a career, whether you are successful ultimately or you're not going to be successful, the industriousness of your nature, your profile will decide it. What is the industriousness starting from? The industry starting from, you have to do hard work in spending time with the client, understanding completely what he wants to say. Then having his brief, you need to research as to what are the facts, what are the issues involved, what is that has been breached, what are the rights taken away from him, or what is he supposed to perform and is not performed. So how are you going to defend him? Are there any precedents? Are there any such cases already there? Or how are you going to distinguish your case? So therefore, you have to spend a lot of time. Maybe sometime, as we call it, burn midnight oil. Because believe me, sometimes you do not have a good sleep because you have a case tomorrow morning and you visualize all sorts of situations as to what the judge is going to ask you, because he may ask anything from anywhere. So you have to be prepared. So a lot of effort has to go in as to where we are going. So I'll not dwell on this in greater detail. You have to have a brief. You must research a brief. You must draft accordingly. You must state clearly the facts and the law. Hard work will only let you know as to what is the fact and what is the applicable law on that. You also have to anticipate the opposite party's reaction, replies, advocate's capability. And then ultimately, you have to work hard on the arguments that may be happening before the judge and what is going to be reaction, what is going to react. You make an argument and what is the counter argument the judge offers to you. So you have to convince him ultimately, because ultimately what will happen is you have to get the judgment in favor of your client. That is what you want. So let's see. What is the next prerequisite for a successful court craft? Eloquence means you as a personality, you as an advocate are supposed to be fluent. You have to have public speaking oratory. You must have good command of vocabulary. Means right words at the right situation. Aptness. Articulation means you must be able to modulate your voice. Speak precisely what is required to be spoken. Speak with punctuation. Modulate your voice. And you have to be persuasive. Means you have to persuade a person that what you are doing, what you are saying is the only right thing available. And therefore, you must go with me. So that is what is that eloquence. All of it is a great virtue for court craft. Let's see the third limb. It's fellowship. Ultimately, as I said, we are managing relationships and the conflicts within the relationships. So we have to be human. We have to see the emotional element there. We have to understand and appreciate the emotion. So fellowship means how we are behaving in the legal society. Your adversary, your opposite advocate, your litigant, So you have to be warm to the judge also. You have to be genial. You have to be affable. Means you are amiable. You are understanding the situation of others. So you cannot blow hot and cold. So you have to be having a considered opinion and respect for others' opinion also. That's what the fellowship means. And you must respect all other human beings that you are interacting in the course of your profession. Let's see what it says. Judgmental. It's judgment. So you have to have your own perception based on what is your knowledge. Your perception cannot be there unless you have knowledge. So therefore, it's important to have knowledge which relates to the industry I mentioned earlier. You have to have time spent on reading the law. Lot of reading is required. Lot of reading of cases is required. Lot of reading of judgments is required. You have a brief in hand, so you must understand similar facts, what the judgments have been, and how you can distinguish. Maybe some of them might have gone against such facts, so you might stand a chance to lose your case. So you must also research as to what will be the distinguishing factor so that your set of facts do not suffer the same fate. So you must have an intuition as to what the judge is going to say, and you must anticipate that. Your perception will come from your knowledge. Your acumen will develop over a period of time as to, acumen is what? Your judgment of a situation at a particular point of time and how you grasp it, your capability. Foresightedness as to when and how you can see things happening, in what direction. So you are prepared. Tactical means you must be tactful so as to able to handle a situation. Tactfully come out of situation. Suppose if you are not prepared for a case or an argument today and judge is hell-bent upon arguing it, how do you get out of the situation? So you must be tactical in a respectful manner. Find out a way to get out of that situation so that you can get a postponement and make the judge agree. Come out with some kind of a this thing where the judge says, okay, we'll do it tomorrow or we'll do it on the next day. Come out with a point which judge says, I'm not familiar with. Let me also look into the file. So probably you have a tactical situation there. So you should be discerning in your judgment as to what is good, what is bad. Then the next is the most important thing I would feel is the honesty. You do not have to win a case at all costs. Because ultimately, you are in the business of discovering the truth. Of course, you make all efforts to win the case for your client. But you should be candid enough, means open enough, forthright enough, truthful enough, frank enough, and upright enough to sincerely tell your client what is the brief that you are getting, what are the chances of securing a good judgment. I'm sure you know that no advocate can guarantee the outcome of a case. You can only assure of the best effort. So if you find that there is a case which is having practically very low chances, you must give a frank assessment also. So honesty, it's not that you want to make money at the cost of your honesty and your professional standards. So you must be sincere, not only to yourself, but to litigants, but to the judge, and but to the other opposite party advocate also. So that's a very important component of your personality, which will help you all these, because you must conduct in the court honestly. Next is the courage part. Courage doesn't mean physical courage, that I can take on the lion or I can take on anybody whosoever he may come. It is not that I'm talking about. I'm talking of courage of conviction. Means how much strong belief you have in yourself, how much strong character you have in yourself, what is the confidence you're carrying. Now, all this, the confidence and the conviction will come from where? The knowledge. Knowledge of what? Knowledge of facts. If you have gone through the brief again and again, again and again, and develop a habit, develop a situation where you can stand before a judge and give him the brief of facts without even looking at your file. Means speak extempore for 15, 20, 30 minutes, give him the facts from A to Z. The judge will appreciate that. He will make sure that he understands that you are thorough with your job. So judge will have to be pretty sure that he's thorough with the judgment and the application of law also. So therefore, you must have the courage of confidence, conviction, which will come from your thoroughness on the facts, thoroughness on the law applicable, so that you can take on the judge also in a very, very polite, very, very firm manner. Okay, sir, this is what the law will apply and what you are perceiving, because in the arguments, the judge will come out with the situation, how this law applies to this particular situation. It doesn't apply to this particular facts. So you have to differ with him. You have to beg to differ with him. And then ultimately, you have to make sure that you make your point clear to him, and probably he'll understand and appreciate if you do it in a very nice, polite manner. And probably he will also, all great judges will appreciate the correctness of the situation. They will appreciate your contribution to his development also, because ultimately judges are also human beings. It's true that you may, some of you may go on to become judges. So this also is a virtue of greatness, where you accept your shortcomings and move on with new learnings. So you have to be having fearlessness in you. You must be persevering. That's again a very important quality in court craft. Persevering means you insist on what you are saying, but not that you insist table pe haath maar ke, ki I'm thumping my table and I say, no, sir, this is the only correct answer. No, that the judge will never appreciate. So you have to persevere with the argument, the thought process, and you have to bring force into your arguments, force of knowledge. You have to persist with it, and intellectual ability will only get you there to develop that courage. If you are not intellectually inclined, if you are not wanting to increase your knowledge through your reading, through your practice, you will never get this courage. Because courage means, if you do not know the law, if you do not know the facts, what courage you will have to stand before the judge? Probably you will want to avoid the judge. You will enter a court thinking, what if the judge doesn't turn up today? I'll get my remuneration if I fixed on an appearance basis. In any case, my remuneration is fixed already for the entire case. So what I stand to lose if the judge doesn't come? So you pray that, okay, judge should be on leave today. The case should not be taken up today. So that is not the courage. Courage is to take it on and let it come. It's only possible if you have the knowledge, if you have the right tools in your armory. What is the next? That is the wit. Wit is basically humor. We can make it. He's a very witty person. So what is wit? Wit is being shrewd, being humorous, getting the lighter side of it when the things are getting hot, when the things are going against you, you naturally cool down the temperature. You use a lot of common sense. You use your intelligence. You be inventive. Use your presence of mind as to how you can get the things in your favor. For example, there is a situation where the witness is appearing. What do you want to do? In law, the witness has some credibility. His credibility matters. So we want to demolish that credibility. So you have to have a presence of mind as to what he is saying, catch each of his word, and then confront him, catch him. So then you can point out to judge, sir, here it is, what I want to say, here he is wrong. And then you catch it and get the judgment in your favor by making or demolishing his credibility. So ultimately, what is your attitude? It has to be a learning attitude. That again will give you some height in your career, in your profession, and it will give you some success as a lawyer. So then only you will be called a good advocate. I've given you all the virtues of court craft, where the court craft has to be practiced, getting all those things into your armory. Let's briefly touch upon the legal drafting aspect. There's very little time on this, so I'll just quickly brush on this. As we already seen, it's an important instrument of legal communication. The art of legal writing is synthesis of facts and law in one particular document itself. I'm not going into the legal aspects of pleading and convincing, which says that you do not present the evidence. You only present the facts and do not present the evidence, but you have to present the facts and the law right away. Because I'm sure you are aware, in the pleadings, whether it is the petition or the written statement by the opposite party, whatever you say first time is the only thing. You cannot add on again and again. Add on becomes subject to the court's permission. So you have to be very particular about drafting so that you don't miss out. You take care of all the facts and take care of all the law, because you cannot be allowed amendments at your will later on. First instance, you can add whatever you want to add relevant, but later on, it's subject to the... So I'm not going to the aspects of pleading per se as per civil procedure code. You know, Order 6, Rule 1, whatever. I'm not going to those. What I'm saying is, it's a crystallization of expression. You are saying that this is what my right is and it should be secured to me. We know drafting is a conceptual thinking and thereafter we compose. We discussed that already in the beginning itself. Now, the development and preparation of documents such as statutes, regulations, ordinances, you know, these are the legislatures who are doing it. The staff of the law ministry is doing it. The parliamentary staff is doing it. But what we are doing as an advocate, we are drafting out contracts, conveyance deeds, etc., etc. Right? So we are supposed to be drafting these particular kind of a documents, which are legal documents. So therefore, we are discussing this art. This also is an art and science. We have to think first and then apply our senses, intellect to come out with a document which is to be considered by the court. Legal drafting first principle is KISS. What is it? Keep it simple, keep it short and simple. That is the first principle, because nobody has the time. You understand the load on the judiciary. Lot of files are there and lot of scarcity of time is there. So if you keep it crisp, short, the judge will have time and inclination to go through. If you present him 10 pages, rather than presenting 2 pages as required, he will probably avoid your file and not go all through. And he might miss your relevant point lying on the 9th page because he's gone only up to 2 pages. Though he is lacking in his duty if he's doing that, but you have no means to correct that. So you must be short and simple and crisp so that all the points come to the attention of the Honorable Court. You have to collect, consolidate and coordinate facts. Have an outline. Use small, simple words, short sentences. Don't give a paragraph as a sentence. Whole paragraph is one sentence. So nobody has the concentration power. After all, we said judge also is a human being. He also has mental fatigue because he's not going through your file only, remember. He's doing so many other things also. He's administering the court. He's going through your file. He's conducting cases. End of the day, he's writing judgments also. So please understand and appreciate, you have to get maximum of his time. You can do that if you are able to do all these things as they are there on your screen now. Here it is. Collect, consolidate, coordinate. Right? And then it has to be numbered. It has to be logically sequenced so that when you are referring to a particular paragraph, a particular situation, the judge can be on the same page as you are. Sir, paragraph number so-and-so, point number so-and-so, so he can understand as to what you are trying to make out to him. What are the principles which are material? The language you must use, which is self-explanatory. Draftsman means the advocate has to appreciate what he's meaning to say. So you must understand what you're saying. If you also don't understand, how will the judge understand? So therefore, use the language which you understand, which you can interpret from your client's point of view. Because the reader is a client. He's explained to you. So he should also be able to understand. Then it means that it is intelligible, you know, to a layman. That yes, what you have written is understood by the layman. So judge, of course, will understand because he's no layman. He's a person who knows the law. He can apply the law to the facts. But this is not an easy job, let me assure you. Drafting is a very difficult job because only training and practice will bring perfection. Document should be clear to person having competent knowledge. Means the person who is in law should know this, that this is, yes, a good document. You must explain complexity in simple terms. which again is a very, very tough situation, tough job, because you have to understand what is the simplicity which is supposed to be brought into your this thing. And judicial interpretation has to be kept in mind. Judge should make out what is the intention of party when a particular statement is being attributed, prepared and given to him for consideration. Ultimately, you should see also that the document is valid enough in terms of legal requirements. That is the, for example, the physical parameters, the size of the paper, the double spacing, the margins on the paper, and so on and so forth. So you have to make sure, and it is presented in a manner it is required to be presented. All the courts have their own rules with regard to the font, the style, the size. So you have to take care. And there should be no ambiguities with regard to any misinterpretation, which probably would lead to miscarriage of justice. If you want to say, I was going north of it. North of it means what? North of a particular situation. So you must specify. So otherwise, judge will also travel north or travel south. So you have to be very clear. There should be no ambiguity. It should be specific to the hilt, so that the judges do not cause you any harm or unintended harm. So I think today's takeaway should include the court craft, which has been simplified in terms of what the qualities of the lawyer should be to be able to conduct the court craft. Craft is your business now. Business means not in the sense of term of carrying out business for profit. Business means your day-to-day activity. So court craft is going to be your day-to-day activity. It has been simplified for you. You must, I'm sure your institute will have a copy of this presentation. You can carry it for your reference. Drafting, of course, is an important tool in your armory of court craft. Now, but please understand, young lawyer friends, my dear friends, that this can only come from hard work. You have to put these skills to practice. Now, most of you would probably join some law firm or some judiciary. You should be taking the initiative, be proactive. Let me tell you from the practice experience, as I see, no seniors will going to be interesting job to you unless he has confidence in you. So you have to do it yourself. You have to be proactive. You must volunteer to do it yourself rather than waiting for him to instruct you. You should be ready with an answer before he asks for it. So you should be able to manage help. You should be able to manage yourself. You should be able to manage files. Be ready with the answer before he even asks you. For example, if it was to, you should have therefore good skills to manage files also to begin with in your career. You should know which paper is lying where, so that when you are assisting him in a court, you should be able to go to the particular relevant portion immediately. That is again an art, because otherwise you will be fumbling before the court and court will not give you that much of a time. So that's also part of the court craft you learn on the job. Now, we have discussed enough on the requirement and the importance of communication. Let me take written communication. Drafting is all but written communication, nothing but written communication. So how many of us do practice vocabulary? Have we ever written a particular petition, a particular letter? So please develop a habit of writing out a petition, a letter, an application every day, so that you learn new words in vocabulary and you put it into practice. Because unless you do practice, unless you do vocabulary additions, you will never be able to put a good drafting into place. So you must do it on your own. No senior will guide you to that. You have to rather seize the opportunity of learning rather than get the opportunity of learning. Now, ultimately, I would like to wish you all the best with a cake. What is a cake all about? This is a ceremonial cake which I want to cut before you. It's a literary cake which I want to give it to you. You can carry it with you. Let's see what the cake stands for. Cake stands for your confidence, your articulation, your knowledge, and you being ethical as an advocate, as a person. So you should be confident. You should be articulate in what you do. You should be able to communicate precisely, because that is your oral code craft. Because ultimately, even if you are good at drafting, very good at vocabulary, very good at communicating in writing, if you are not able to speculate or articulate in your presentation to the court, in your arguments to the court, you are not going to be successful. You may miss out what is written in the file. So what is that good for? Ultimately, you have to articulate also. Be precise in whatever you present in a very clear manner. That you can do only if you have knowledge of law as well as the facts of your brief. As I said, you should know the brief as the palm of your hand. And ethical, you have to be honest, you have to be courageous, and you have to make sure that you're working in the best interest of justice for all. And the concluding point for you as a young lawyer would be, I would say, nobody can make you feel inferior without your consent. Because if you are feeling inferior, it means there is something lacking in you. And that is because of your initiative or lack of effort. You are not doing something, so therefore somebody is scolding you. If your junior or your senior, whosoever he may be, or somebody is giving you a warning, somebody is giving you a situation, it means you are giving your consent to it. Why not doing a particular situation or particular activity to his satisfaction? So therefore, you are what you believe. So believe yourself to be a very brilliant person, intellectual person, have the capability to learn and acquire new skills. And you should work for it. Develop a learning aptitude so that you can get altitude in your life. So I think you have been a wonderful audience. Of course, now we cannot say that for you, because I have not had the opportunity of seeing your faces, not even able to see your body language or eye contact or your receptivity. But I would say, nevertheless, you would have enjoyed my presentation today, and thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for categorically discussing all the topics and nitty-gritties relating to code craft and drafting to our students. I hope they have benefited from it. Sir, some of our students has put forward some questions through the chat. I would like to put it to you. The first question is from a student, and she is asking how a student must manage his internship at college and his college attendance and legal internship at the same time.
College attendance and legal internship.
Legal internship at the same time.
Again, it's about management of time. All of us have 24 hours in a day. Nobody has 25 hours. Have you heard of anybody having 25 hours? I'm sure nobody has. So the people who have a lot of time, there are other people who have no time. So whom do you think is managing time? The person who has a lot of time is managing, or the person who has no time is managing? The person who has a lot of time is the only person who is managing, because he knows what is being effective, what things need to be done. So therefore, he does not waste time on irrelevant things. Now, coming back to the attendance part of it and the internship part of it. Normally, as I understand, internships do happen in vacations as well as over the period when the institution is not asking you or wanting you to be attending the classes. Now, no advocate would want you. It's the students who want to do the two things at the same time. You should either do the internship during the vacations, or if you're doing during the classes, attend the classes and thereafter go to the courts, lawyer chambers in the evening or office in the evening. So you can manage two things simultaneously. There is no overlap as far as I believe.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to next question. Student is asking that if we give a legal advice being a law student, not as an advocate, then are we protected by the privilege status under the Advocates Act?
The answer lies in your question itself. Unless you are an advocate, how can you be protected? It is a privilege given to the advocates only, particularly those advocates who are now required to even qualify the AIBE, All India Bar Examination, so that you can appear in a court of law. Even a lawyer who is not passed that, probably he won't enjoy, though he is enjoying, that's my interpretation, he is not qualified enough to give an advice. Imagine an intern doctor being allowed to operate a person. Would he get away with it? he would not. No, because he's not got a degree of practice. He's not got a certificate of practice. So he cannot practice his craft, I would say now, without license. So you are not, you know driving, but you have no license to drive. So you are asking a question as if, sir, I know driving. If I kill somebody, would I get punished for not for driving without a license? Obviously, you will get punished. So therefore, no immunity.
So okay. The follow-up question is from the same student that yes. In case we are a law student, can we participate in any legal aid by which we can help the needy person who have legal problems?
Yes, you can always do that. The honorable courts do conduct Lok Adalats. They conduct legal service clinics. So you conduct, you contact any of the district courts. All of them have cells or legal aid cells. Right. So you can go there. There are some NGOs who are working in the field of extending legal aid to poor society or poor sections of the society. So you can always join them, learn on the job, as we call it, experience it, and probably you'll be a better person.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to the next question. How we will be able to control our conduct in court when we are arguing before court, knowing we are right, but the judge is not understanding our point of view?
Very good question. This is exactly the court craft I was trying to touch and present. You know, there is something called eloquence I touched upon. Can we have that slide again? The courage. Or should I go ahead? Can you? I think it will be, I think third or fourth we discussed in the middle part. When we reach the lamps, sixth lamp. Yeah, you should go back. Yes. Next one. Next. No, not the previous one, the next one. I'm on the sixth lamp. On the top, if you see the heading, it's the third lamp. Go to the sixth one. Two slides thereafter now. Yes, further next. What you are talking about is the courage. It is not physical courage that you should be able to take the judge on. You know, you have to have intellectual capability to humbly submit to a judge that what you are saying is because of this conviction that you have. Conviction will come from where? Your knowledge about the law, your knowledge about the precedent law. I'm sure judges are also human beings, as we touched upon. He also has a particular set of knowledge, particular level of knowledge, particular level of intellect. Now, he is handling so many things, so many cases every day. So he is thinking out of his common sense that, okay, I've handled this situation earlier, this kind of a case earlier in my career. So this also should be there, applicable to this. You have to differentiate your case from those cases which are already actively in his mind. That, okay, maybe your facts are different. So you have to have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 cases to be able to tell you that, okay, sir, no, this is the actual correctual position of the facts. And this is the law to be applied. Now, advocacy, as also the judgeship, the art of judging, is also applying the law to the set of facts. So you have to tell him, sir, how this particular law is applicable to your set of facts, or how this act or law is not applicable to your set of facts, which he is trying to apply. So you have to be politely and in a warm manner, differ with him, persist with him, persevere with your thought. And if he is, for example, too hot today to handle, take a time. Okay, sir, I would need some more time to convince you about my argument. I'll maybe come back with some more judgments, precedents. So therefore, give me an opportunity. And all good judges will give you that opportunity. And that also will give you some time to do more research, as also for the judge to reflect in his heart to heart. Yes, he was wrong and the advocate was right. So handle a situation, as I said, with tact also. We have discussed that it will have to be handled with a tact. So tact and courage and combination of all these lamps, court craft, will get you out of the situation. Yes, next question.
Thank you, sir. Our next question is, how to manage our emotions in court where we are practicing as a criminal advocate and we know that our client has committed crime actually?
Very good question again. See, as I said, now it's good that you have brought in the human element to the proceedings. You get that information that yes, he has committed the crime. For what reason? Because it's a fiduciary relationship. He will not go and admit before the judge, sir, I have committed this crime. So he is only admitted it to you in private, in person, in trust. So you know it. That's only as far as the brief is concerned. But as far as the law is concerned, you have to see in similar situations, what was the fate of the criminal. Now, I'm not saying, and there are situations where you have been able to get away from a situation of murder and you have not been convicted because as a judge, you do not decide on emotions. So as an advocate also, you should not decide on emotions. You cannot base your arguments also on emotions. You cannot say, no, this man has killed a person. So what if I am his lawyer defending him? He should get the punishment because that is what my emotive side is telling me. You know, but as a professional, I should forget about my emotive side. I should only work on the facts and getting justice for my client. And maybe he has committed a crime. Okay. But my job today, or rather duty today to my client is to save him. Even if he has committed a wrong, there lies the beauty of my profession, my craft. You know, it will give me more satisfaction if I can convince the court. How will I convince the court? Because of, if there's a direct evidence, the court will appreciate. If there is a weak case, I will demolish the credibility of the evidence. I will demolish the credibility of the witness standing there. I'll say, sir, he was the only person who was there on the site. There was no eyewitness to it. How can the other witnesses be relied upon it? Let the circumstantial evidence be taken into account. So let's not get carried away by emotion because law does not work on emotions. It works only on logic, only on common sense, and only on evidence. Nothing else. Yes.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to your last and final question. It's a statement and followed by a question. The student is saying court craft cannot be learnt in short term, but in long term, at least in 10 years. This is what we learn or what we hear when we go on to do internship from senior lawyers. Is it true? Sir, what is your point of view?
As I said, court craft learning is a lifelong experience. It's not a short-term 100-meter dash. It's a marathon. It is something which has to be acquired over a period of time. Maybe you are born with a good oratory. You are born with a good grasping power. That, okay, there is a written communication in front of you. You read through it. If I present a page to one student, he goes through the page in 1 minute. Other student may take 2 minutes. Some other student may take 5 minutes. Because teacher teaches everything to all the students. But some students get 60% marks, some students get 95% marks. Why? Because our grasping power is different. Our comprehension of a situation is different. What you interpret, I interpret differently. So there is no shortcut to success, as we call it. So you have to spend time. As I said repeatedly, you must have initiative. You must have the willingness. You must have the proactiveness to do things on your own. Because no senior, unfortunately or fortunately, will do spoon feeding for you. If you want to learn court craft, as Justice Deepak Gupta said, and I showed you a slide in this thing, please be in the court rather than be in the bar room or the canteen. He didn't use the word canteen. I'm using the word canteen because I find most of the interns go to Honorable High Court, go to Supreme Court in Delhi. You'll find less number of advocates standing and sitting there having coffee, more number of interns sitting there and enjoying coffee, gossiping as if it's a college canteen. That time has to be spent in the courtroom. Then you can reduce the 10-year period to maybe 5-year period, maybe 3-year period. So you can expedite the process of learning. Say, for example, if a learned advocate or famous advocate, say like Mr. Kapil Sibal, Mr. Chidambaram, or for example, yesterday's Mr. Arun Jaitley was arguing before a court. Would you get that opportunity? Does a common man have that opportunity to go and sit in the courtroom? No. You as a young advocate have that opportunity, the permissions to go and court and sit there and watch what are the proceedings happening, how the judge is responding to a situation, how the advocate is responding to a situation. That situation will register in your mind. Whether this gentleman or the advocate is totally academic, he quotes only for academics. Does he have the wit and the humor? Does he take the judge through a journey? You know, there are advocates who travel with the facts. As if you're traveling from Delhi to Chandigarh or Delhi to Bombay, they'll take you over a journey of facts. You know, everybody has his oratory skills. So this can only be learnt in the courtrooms. Justice Deepak Gupta said very rightly. So it is no shortcut. You have to learn over a period of time. Maybe you may have a head start, right? Head start means when the gunfire goes, you may jump the first step like a Powell, you know, but otherwise you have to run with him only and follow him. So that's what my answer is. It is, of course, a long-term process. It's marathon. You have to run the marathon, but with your stamina, consistency, and not follower in the middle path only. You have to finish the race. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir, for guiding us. Thank you so much for being part of this PD workshop. I'm sure students have benefited from this PD workshop in a categorical manner. The way you explain the thing, the way you answer the questions in a very categorical and beautiful manner with examples, I am sure that would be a guiding for their future career. Thank you once again from Geeta Ratan International Business School and Geeta Ratan International Business School Center for Legal Studies. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, it was my privilege, and I was given this opportunity. I enjoyed the opportunity thoroughly, and it was equally good for me. And I'm sure the students also would have enjoyed this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Pleasure.
So our today's PD workshop ends here. And thank you, everyone, for attending.